Chicago has never been a quiet city. It's boisterous, rollicking, full of voices and opinions. They come from boardrooms and classrooms, from the trading floors and from the neighborhoods. At the Tribune, we've long sought out those voices, starting conversations worth sharing. We do it in papers and on television, on our smartphones and tablets, in classrooms and on stages, in small numbers and large. Tribune. Chicago Forward. Press Pass. Printer's Row. Chicago has plenty to say. Join the conversation at Trib Nation events.
Hi, good evening. Welcome. On behalf of editor Jerry Kern and publisher Tony Hunter and all of my Tribune colleagues, I thank you for coming. Tonight's Chicago Forward is part of our public policy series. Trib Nation presents 100 programs a year, our way of bringing Chicago Tribune journalism to the stage. I'd like to introduce first Thomas O'Neill of ComEd. He is Senior Vice President for Regulatory and Energy Policy and General Counsel there. Support by ComEd makes these programs possible, and we are very grateful for that. Please welcome Mr. O'Neill.
Thank you, Joyce, and welcome everyone. You now know my name and you know my title, so I can skip that. On behalf of ComEd, though, I do want to welcome all of you to the Tribune's Chicago Forward series of public dialogues, and especially to tonight's event on the subject of marriage equality. We at ComEd are extremely proud to sponsor this Chicago Forward series to help facilitate open and honest debate about important topics in our world, in our state, and in our city. Tonight's topic, as you all know, is quite timely. And we trust that this forum and these panelists will provide all of us with a greater understanding of the perspectives on all sides of this issue. Our panelists are all invested in tonight's topic of marriage equality, and I want to thank them on behalf of ComEd for being here and for appearing before all of you to share their respective views on this subject. I also wish to thank Joyce and Bruce Dold and everyone at the Tribune for facilitating this event and for hosting the Chicago Forward series, which I now have a greater understanding of just what an impact it's making in the community. So thank you all once again for being here. Welcome, and let's get started.
Thanks again to ComEd, and thanks also to the Museum of Broadcast Communications. This is a beautiful space, and we are delighted to be here. The Tribune considers it a responsibility and a privilege, actually, to convene these conversations. Tonight's topic is the future of marriage. Less than 20 years ago, 68% of Americans opposed same-sex marriage. Today, 55% support it, according to a recent national poll by Bloomberg. A new pope has called for compassion and context in discussions within the Catholic Church on same-sex marriage and other social issues. Political leaders and voters are engaged in a public debate that once was really thought unthinkable. In June, the U.S. Supreme Court struck down a major section of the Federal Defense of Marriage Act that cleared the way for gay marriage in California. Today, 13 states and the District of Columbia recognize same-sex marriage, and 35 states, including Illinois, prohibit it. Last month, a judge in New Jersey ordered that the state allow gay marriage, though Governor Chris Christie has just asked the New Jersey Supreme Court to overturn that decision. Here in Illinois, state law permits civil unions, but same-sex marriage is a topic of intense debate. The Illinois Senate passed the Religious Freedom and Marriage Fairness Act in February, but that bill has not been called for a vote in the House. A lawsuit challenging Illinois' ban on same-sex marriage is making its way through the courts in Cook County. a status hearing next week on that. So we have tonight an extraordinary panel to sort through this issue. Bruce Dold, the Tribune's editorial page editor, will lead the discussion. We have State Representative Greg Harris, lead sponsor of the Religious Freedom and Marriage Fairness Act. We have Chicago Alderman Deborah Mell. We have Peter Breen, vice president and senior counsel for the Thomas More Society. And Robert Gilligan, executive director of the Catholic Conference of Illinois. We thank them for being here. Just a little bit of business. We'll take written questions, so I think you probably have some cards. If you have something you want to ask, hold your card up. It'd be great if you could silence your phones, though feel free to tweet. After the program, we will offer a little sip of wine to continue the conversation. And with that, please join me in welcoming Bruce Dold and our distinguished panel.
Great crowd. Thank you all for being here. I appreciate you doing this. I want to jump right in. There's a political track on this issue, and there's a legal track on this issue. And I think first we ought to let folks know where both of those stand. And Greg, you are the... Greg. You are the lead sponsor of the bill, and which passed the Senate pretty easily. You didn't call it in the House. You got quite a bit of grief from supporters for not calling it. Where does it stand now? What's the likelihood that you will call it when the legislature goes back in October?
Well, as you know, Bruce, the bill is SB 10, is ready to be considered in the House of Representatives. It is on the agenda, and we go back to Springfield for veto session soon. I hope this can be one of the things that gets done, because there are, as were mentioned in the opening remarks, there are now thousands and thousands of Illinois families who are suffering real harms every day because they are not getting the protections and do not have the responsibility that marriage affords. It's what the majority of people in the country want and what the majority of people in Illinois want, and I'd like to get it done sooner rather than later.
Why didn't you call it for a vote, get everyone on the record, see where they were?
Some of my colleagues said, we really need to go back and have more of a dialogue. This is one of the great issues of our time. Some of my colleagues said, we wanted some more time to go back and talk to our constituents about that. And I felt it was respectful, and I thought it was the right thing to do, to give them that time. And of course, since that day, the Supreme Court has ruled and the landscape has changed. The Supreme Court of the United States has now ruled that there's no legitimate reason under law to treat one family differently than another family. And I think a lot of my colleagues have gone back, they've taken in that message, and they understand the import on our state.
How many votes would it have today if you called it?
I never talk about roll calls. I hate to prognosticate, because no matter what number I say, I'll probably be a little bit off.
All right, ballpark.
I would hate to have the Tribune right. Harris promised a sex number of votes.
We're off the record.
Okay.
Sure.
Everyone plug your ears, and I will give you a number.
Give or take.
Yeah.
Right. Peter, there is a court path, too. Your organization is defending the state's current law. Would you tell us, Sophia Hall issued a ruling that let that suit go forward, but on a narrower basis. Can you tell us where that stands?
Sure, and we're representing five downstate county clerks who came into the case in order to defend the state's marriage laws. We were able to get three of the five claims dismissed, so now two claims remain, and those will proceed. But really, the legal track is going to also track with the public policy track. The question is the same in the public policy versus the law. What does marriage mean? Is it about the needs of the children? Is it about the desires of adults? That's really where the decision in court is going to track the same way.
Mm-hmm. There's a ruling in New Jersey this week. The judge said that essentially the Supreme Court decision means that New Jersey cannot constitutionally prohibit same-sex marriage. How is that going to affect what happens here?
Well, and that the same arguments were made in our case, and the judge didn't pick up on those arguments or didn't advance those, the Windsor case arguments from the Supreme Court. And it, really, Windsor itself says it was limited to lawful same-sex marriages in those states. So the idea is, hey, for the states that have decided marriage is merely a love commitment, then they're going to be allowed to do that. The federal government will respect that. For states that want to maintain marriage as a union of a man and a woman so that they can raise the children that they produce, those states are going to be able to continue that under federal law.
And I think, though, that Windsor does go a little bit beyond that. It also talks about how states have the right to determine how to treat folks equally under the law, and the Windsor case said that people were not being treated equally in the eyes of the law in those states. And obviously those are being done on a state-by-state basis because each state has a different constitutional structure, and that will play out. And I think that's what Judge Hall will listen to the arguments for and against.
But frame the argument. What's left before Judge Hall? What is this case going to turn on?
Well, and the plaintiffs have made a claim under the Equal Protection Clause of the Illinois Constitution and the Due Process Clause. Equal protection really is the key argument. That's the one that everybody's looking to. The issue is, are same-sex couples being discriminated against by having opposite-sex couples allowed to marry and same-sex couples not being allowed to marry? So again, it really comes down to that clash of worldviews, which is, what is marriage about? Is it really tied in with that procreation and with the children, or is it really tied into just two people who love each other?
Deb, you got married 2 years ago?
I did.
You couldn't get married in Chicago.
That's correct.
You went to Iowa to get married. I listened to your very impassioned speech on the floor of the House when this came up in the legislature. What is, from a personal standpoint, sort of what protections do you have today in Illinois because you got married in Iowa? What don't you have?
Well, I think they're still kind of sorting that out, right? So the federal government is still looking at the case, what the Supreme Court did, and they're still, right now you could say that there's 11,000 rights that I don't have now, but if I crossed the river and I lived in Iowa, I would have 11 more protections and responsibilities and freedoms federally, right? So now in Illinois, I don't have those, but like I said, if I just crossed the Mississippi River, I would have those. Or if I went to Minnesota or the 13 other states that have. Mm.
Would you have more rights if you had opted for a civil union in Illinois than?
Well, I think like immigration, and I think we're seeing now with filing tax returns and stuff, that people who got marriage licenses, it's not necessarily residency based. But I mean, this is all very confusing, and this is new, and it needs to be, all sorted out. So, mm-hmm.
Just from a personal standpoint, right. Why did you decide to go to Iowa to get married rather than go with a civil union in Illinois? Right.
Well, Bruce, I met Kristen, and if you indulge me for a second, I have to say hi to her. She's out of town on work, and she's watching though. So, hi, honey. We call her the First Lady of the 33rd Ward, so she's going to love it that I said that. We've been together for 9 years, 7 years by the time we decided I proposed to her. And it just, our relationship just kind of took the normal path that relationships take, right? So we met, fell in love. When Chris and I got together, my mom was in the throes of a horrific disease, and so Kristen was with me all during that time, and when my mom passed away in 2006. And, there becomes a time in a relationship where, partner isn't enough, girlfriend is not enough, right? And civil union is not enough. And society says that marriage, this is recognized throughout the world, right? Marriage is the highest level you give to people who love each other. And I love my wife. And she loves me. And we wanted to get in front of our family, friends, and church, and we wanted to tell everyone that we're going to make a commitment to each other. And whatever throws at us, and Bruce, there's been a lot, right, with my family. And we've stuck together, and we've weathered it. And that's pretty much it. I mean, we wanted to get in front of our friends and family and say we want to build a life together. We want to make this commitment in front of God and in front of our family and friends. And marriage... our relationship deserves the label marriage. And, you know, thousands of other Illinoisans deserve the same label.
Bob, the Catholic Conference has lobbied very strongly against the bill in Illinois. What is the faith argument against changing the definition of marriage?
Well, the Catholic Conference has argued this not only in terms of our faith perspective, but look, there's a lot of faiths out there that have different perspectives on this issue. What we've tried to communicate to members of the General Assembly is sort of the natural order. So by nature, man and women have a gender, and they come together in a marriage for the purpose of raising children. I have no doubt that Alderman Mell loves her, your partner. I don't,
my wife.
I don't dispute that. I don't think you're committed to each other. You love each other. We agree with that. But that's not the issue here. What you're talking about is the law. And we're talking about what the government's role in public policy is. And the point of departure is that under what Alderman Mell has described, that's an emotion. And the government does not have any role in emotion. It doesn't have a role in relationships. What I've just proposed to you is that marriage is the union between one man and one woman. And there's one man and one woman. And that has an underlying principle and rationale. And the underlying principle and rationale is that man and that woman come together for the purposes of creating a child, and that is a public good. And that's why marriage is unique for a reason. It's treated in law differently, the union between one man and one woman, for that public good. Because that's how we transmit our values, that's how we transmit our faith, and that's how we continue with society. So love and commitment is not enough to change the natural order of things. The other thing I'd like to point out is that, so we have a man and a woman. Those are two people that come together. We have the number two. But under this proposal that redefines marriage and changes the radical definition of marriage, once you take gender out of a marriage, what do you have left? You have a relationship between any two people. So why is the number two now important? Why can't it be three or four or five or whatever? You know, I can tell people are snickering. I know, there are people applauding. Continue applauding.
Yeah.
But, you know, years ago, I'd have thought, that's crazy talk. But that's no longer. That's the new reality. And I think what we have here is an attempt to redefine and undermine marriage that has existed from time immemorial. This is not a new concept. Every civilization that is around today, every civilization that's been able to record itself was able to do so because they had the institution of marriage that bound women and men together the way no other relationship and no other institution can.
And I'd like to just, you know, talk a little bit about what this law does and what this law does not do. And as a state, we need to be respectful of all the different faiths and denominations which practice and worship in our state. And certainly the Catholic Conference and the Catholic Church has made clear their view that marriage should not be between two people of the same gender. It should be between a man and a woman. And we need to be very respectful of that decision. On the other hand, there are many churches in our state, as we know, which wish to consecrate those marriages, who believe that marriage between two loving people are the right thing to do. And again, I go back, this is an argument we've heard in other states, it's just disingenuous. You can read the law, it talks about two people. We're not talking about polygamy or, you know, multiple, we're talking about two loving people in a committed relationship, in a stable relationship. And we need to respect how each of these faiths and denominations defines marriage within its tradition. But at the same time, in the eyes of law, when folks come down to the county clerk's office to get their license, the government needs to treat them all equally.
And I would I would just, you know, like to add that, you know, today there are many different kinds of families, right? We have children being brought up with grandparents. We have older folks who want to get married and join in that commitment and get all those, the benefits and freedoms and everything. We have straight couples who don't want to have children who get married, you know? So, I mean, we run the gamut of families. And I wish I could take every single person here and my friend Mary Roberts' house, where she has three beautiful children, and see what that's like, you know, and how those children are loved and cared for and read to at night. And that's what's important for children. You know, I mean, they need to know that there's two people in the house or parents who love them. That's what matters.
Well, like, those children can still be read to regardless of whether the law says that what marriage states.
I'm sorry, Bob, I don't mean to interrupt you, but those children go to school and they're with other children and their parents your parents aren't married, you know, I mean, how does that affect the children? And I think Justice Kennedy, in his decision, that was one of the big things, was how does it affect the children of same-sex couples?
What Alderman Mell is proposing here, I think this is important to point out. What Alderman Mell and Representative Harris are saying is that we have a group of people here who are same-sex attracted, and they want to be married, and they want additional rights that they cannot have today. But what the audience needs to understand, and what the General Assembly needs to understand, is it's not that simple. When you change the law, it doesn't mean that just this group of people gets more rights. The law is a blunt instrument, and what it does is it changes the rules for everybody. So the example that you gave, Alderman Mell, which is what happens in the public school system? What is taught in the public school system when we redefine marriage? So for those of us who know that children are best raised in a home with a mother and the father, can that be taught in the public school system anymore?
What about the teachers?
I'd like to talk about
teachers.
The law is actually a very fine instrument on that, and it's very clear.
It's blunt.
It's very clear in the
it's
fact
blunt.
That in the state of Illinois, and I can only speak as a state representative about the state of Illinois, curriculum decisions are made by local school districts. There is nothing in SB 10 that deals with anything regarding what may or may not be taught in schools. I think most kids, they learn their values at home from their parents.
Right.
When you redefine marriage, what's the defense if you don't want to teach that marriage is not between
that,
a man and a woman?
We have some faiths that respect marriage in one way, others that respect another. We need to treat them both equally
the
in the eyes of the
we're talking
and
about
treat
the law.
Them equally
now,
in the eyes
ask
of
you,
the law.
Let me ask you this. We do that there are more same-sex couples that have children, who are raising children. Are those children not better off if they have the protection of a married family than they are if you deny that to them?
Well, children are, look, statistics indicate, social science tells us, that we cannot redefine marriage to be something that it's not. And children are best raised in the home with a man and a woman, so gender matters in a marriage.
Okay, wait.
So science actually says, if you look at studies that have been done by the Child Welfare League, the American Psychological Association, the American Academy of Pediatrics, they all say that gay and lesbian couples make just fine folks along
you
with
got
straight
studied,
people.
You got studied, Representative Harris, before we do the applause meters, look, there's studies out there that say, you know, all these studies they're citing, the sample sizes are extremely low. Look, the fact of the matter is, let's be honest, we've only had this type of relationship within the past, let's say 10 years, it's been legal in Massachusetts. So longitudinally, we don't know the answer to that question. We need a lot more time to go by to accurately measure that, to say if that statement is valid or not.
And every day that goes by, there are children who are harmed because they don't have the protections that marriage gives their family. If somebody finds themselves in an emergency room, there may not be a parent to be at their side. And I don't think that's what you want, Bob, is it?
No, but what you're arguing is that you are going to take one gender out of the marriage equation. You're going to the public policy, what you're arguing is that the public policy of the state of Illinois should be that, well, in fathers don't matter or mothers don't matter. And what we're saying is the public policy should say that mothers and fathers both marry, because that's how we both got here. That's the natural order.
Stable families, committed families, and strong communities matter.
Well, but what we're,
I think
we're
we
not
disagree.
We're not arguing the contrary. The issue is what the instances you've raised can be easily dealt with under the law and are dealt with under current state law. whether it's the civil union law or in any situation where you've got a child who's in an adoptive relationship, you make account for a different family structure, a different unit, and we do that as a society, really for the sake of
Peter,
kids.
Let me ask you a question then, you know, based on what's in current law. There was a group that formed today, Veterans for Marriage Equality. These are veterans who have served our country, you know, gone overseas, they fought for our freedom. Because of the Supreme Court decision, should they be married and live in the state of Illinois, they cannot. Patrick Bova and Jim Darby, together, I think they just had their 50th anniversary, both served. What they want to do is get married and actually be buried in a veteran's cemetery next to each other. They can't do that today. The law does not allow them to do that because they cannot get married in the state of Illinois. So there's just one example.
But now, Greg, that may not necessarily be true because the IRS just came out with a regulation saying no matter where your marriage license
has
is from.
The Department of Defense has a different rule.
But you see, but we're talking about little issues that can be dealt with, but it doesn't go to whether we redefine a fundamental institution in our society, which is marriage, which has always been tied to the procreation of children, really always about the needs of those kids. Because all the love in the world, I mean, and all due respect to these couples, a mom can't be made into a dad, and a dad can't be made into a mom with all the love in the world. And we know. We each got our cheering section, so yeah. But look, you know, and with the arguments about how a child is best raised, whatever the studies say, we know that a child's own biological mom and dad in a stable relationship best raise that child. We know that, and we can agree on that. If there's some other situation for the child, then other arrangements are made. We've done that in society, though, since for time immemorial. But we know that the child's own mother and father in a stable relationship will best raise that child.
And there are, I would say there are some kids.
There they go again.
And there are some kids, you know, who are raised by loving same-sex couples. There are some kids who are raised by very loving adoptive and foster care families. So, you know, a family is a family, and love is love. And I think that we need to respect that.
Right. And then, I forgot what I was saying. Go ahead.
That's okay.
Thanks,
Deb.
You're welcome.
Keep that
up. This is kind of a scare tactic that we've heard from the opposition, right? That same-sex couples, like children, are going to be harmed and everything. It's factually untrue.
But we haven't said that.
Nobody said that.
And we have multiple highly respected agencies that say so. So it's a scare tactic.
My original question for Peter and Bob is that you do have children who are being raised in same-sex couples. Those are facts regardless of the law. Do they not deserve some protection in that relationship that they don't receive when you don't permit that couple, the parents, to marry?
But again, Bruce, we've always had children who are in adoptive relationships since the beginning. Life happens, whether it's a divorce, whether it's an untimely death of one parent or both. You've always had situations like this. So we as a society have always had to deal with this, and we've always had to protect those children. And so whatever we need to do on that front doesn't require us to redefine the fundamental institution of marriage. And so it's really a false comparison there.
No, Peter's right. That doesn't mean we need to redefine marriage. I think what you're saying is, well, then we can deal with... You asked a very broad question. So specifically, I mean, what are you talking about individually? And we can deal with those needs on an individual basis, as opposed to, as Peter just proposed, that we need to redefine marriage for everybody.
Mm-hmm. First two words of the Religious Freedom and Marriage Fairness Act are religious freedom. I think there are serious concerns about whether this bill really would protect religious freedom. And I think about one of the unintended consequences of the civil union law was that the Catholic Church got out of the adoptions and foster care business after serving the state extremely well for many, many years. What assurances are there that you won't see that this bill actually does protect religious freedom?
Well, first of all, I just want to clear up the misconception that the civil union law had anything to do with that particular instance you mentioned. That was a lawsuit that was actually filed by the Catholic Conference. It wasn't, you know, anything that, you know, the civil union law had anything to do with, where they became a contractor to the state, and as part of their agreement, They, along with every other contractor, have to agree to a decades-old law, the Human Rights Act, which says you cannot discriminate against people in the state of Illinois based on race, religion, national origin, sexual orientation, or veteran status, or disability, and a couple other categories. That was the issue there, where a group who had signed an agreement saying that we would abide by this.
But the church had done this for decades.
Right.
And wow. The distinction here wasn't it that the church had to make a decision between its faith, belief, and its work in this field.
Well, and just as the attorney, or one of the attorneys for the Catholic Charities of the four different dioceses, I can tell you that the reason the lawsuit was brought was because the governor was attempting to end this 90-year-long ministry that the church had. The church had care of 2,000 children. If that were a state foster care system, it would have been larger than the foster care systems of 14 states. And we were playing roulette, Russian roulette, with these children. There was nothing in the civil union law that required the church to be stripped of their ability to do foster care. They signed the law, the contract, the same as every other contractor, and they were fully able to do so. They were fully in compliance with the Human Rights Act. There was no problem on the church's end. It was that the governor, based on his interpretation of the law, said, you can't do this anymore. So we had to sue in order to try to maintain our right to do it. We were not violating any laws, and that needs to be made clear, because the Human Rights Act has exceptions for sectarian foster care agencies.
And I think a judge in Central Illinois ruled that in this case, your position did not rule the day, and that the best interest of the child, the doctrine of the best interest of the child, was what had to govern the state's placement.
Not what the judge ruled. The only thing the judge ruled on, he didn't get into those issues. The only thing the judge ruled, and we're in the weeds here, but the only thing the judge ruled on is that Catholic Charities did not have a right to a state contract, and therefore the state could contract with whomever it wanted to. It didn't get into any of the issues that you're outlining.
And right now it's in contracts with other organizations and other religious organizations, and they place children based on the best needs of the adoptive or foster child, and I think that's the way it should be.
Except you lost thousands of Catholic foster parents process.
But the other thing about this issue that Bruce brings up, and I think it's important to point this out as well, is that there were assurances given on the Senate floor when they were debating this legislation. And it was very clear, the message to us was, and I'm almost quoting it, religious organizations do not have to worry about their ministries, because all this law is doing is, once again, it is affording additional rights to those people, same-sex couples, that don't currently have them. So it was sold, if you will, and marketed as something that just provides additional rights to a small number of people. But once again, that's not the way the law works. The law is a blunt instrument, and it cuts through all sorts of aspects of society that some are not even seeing today. I brought up the example of what happened what will be taught in the public school systems. What will teachers be obliged to teach in the school systems? We talked about Catholic Charities. Well, what about other religious organizations? What about employment benefits for religious organizations? Will we have to provide a benefit for a diocesan employee who happened to get into one of these type of arrangements? And then finally, the other thing we've never talked about is, what about individuals? You know, the First Amendment should apply to individuals as well. And what we've seen happen, unfortunately, in other states, a wedding photographer in the state of New Mexico can no longer be in business because that wedding photographer now is being compelled to participate in something that wedding photographer finds objectionable.
I don't think New Mexico even has same-sex marriage, so I'm not sure what the case is.
And that's just the sort of dangers that we're talking about here. That's exactly what we're talking about.
You know what? You know, Bruce. You know, Bruce and Bob, with all due respect, this is, again, this is not what is in SB 10. This is a scare tactic that they continually use. Like, there's going to be, it's just not the case. I mean, the fact is that we allow marriage in Illinois, and there's statistics out there that says it's like $100 million over 3 years to, you know, to benefit our economy. So, you know, the florists and the caterers and the venues, I mean, this is good for our economy, and this is good for our Illinois businesses.
Just
and I'm really heartened, because as much as they want to keep throwing this stuff out, right, that I'm going to make a horrible parent and I can't parent and
Now, we have not done
that's
that.
That's never
as
well, once.
No, not once. Okay, not once. Not once.
So, but what I am disheartened is that we're seeing that's not working, right? So polling, throughout, Illinois just keeps getting better and better, and support keeps getting better and better. You see it totally, along the gamut, even among, Catholic Americans. And my in-laws are, actually, Kristen's whole family. I mean, I was born Catholic, but that's a long story, but... which I'm sure you don't want me to get into.
You can get it.
Next point.
No, yeah. I don't think you do. Okay. But Kristen's family is Catholic, right? Her whole family is Catholic. And, it was an evolution process for them, right? I mean, her parents weren't, they didn't believe in marriage when we first got together. But the more they got to know us and the more they realized that we are more alike than we are different and that... we live similar lives, we value the same things, that these scare tactics aren't, it's not adding up for them, right? They're like, wait a minute, I see this family, and I see these two women, and they love their children, and I see them thriving, and I see that they need protections and benefits, and their union and their family should be lifted up as just as high as everybody else's. And so I'm so we're going to continue to hear this rhetoric, but I'm really happy that it's people aren't believing it anymore, and that we are moving to a fair and just society. And it's so upsetting that Illinois isn't at the forefront of this. This is about equal rights, right? And Iowa and Minnesota are coming here to poach people and couples to go get married up there. That should be unacceptable for Illinois. And we're a much better state for that. And I look forward to the passage of the bill.
Just very quickly, two things. If these are scare tactics, et cetera, then why don't you put some protections in the bill? If it's not that big a deal, then why don't you put it in the bill, number one? Secondarily, there's been a letter sent to every member of the General Assembly which states that this bill that's pending has the weakest religious liberty protections of any legislation in the country. So it's not only Peter and myself who are saying this. This has been validated by people who are experts. So if it's not that big a deal, just put it in the bill. And
there are people who have written letters to the General Assembly saying these are very strong protections also. So I understand that our sides have differing views, but I brought a copy of the bill. We can look through, and I can read the language out loud to you, that religious freedom protections are guaranteed in this bill. It's in black and white.
Reading on it, if I'm right, the bill specifically protects churches, but it does not have an individual conscience, any language about individual conscience. And I think we've also seen with the Affordable Care Act, where a distinction is made between a church, the direct institution, and religious organizations that were not granted the same kind of protection. I mean, would the bill not have a better chance if it had an individual conscience protection?
I think as a state, decades ago when the Human Rights Act was passed, that said we the people of Illinois have decided not to allow discrimination based on race, religion, sexual orientation, disability, veteran status, and housing, employment, or public accommodations. The question of should we treat all of our citizens equally in those three areas has been answered. But also, there are exemptions for religious institutions in the Human Rights Act. There's also the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, and specific language in this bill, again, I brought it with me in case anyone cared to read it, that explicitly protects the freedom of religion for those churches and denominations which do not want to consecrate same-sex marriages. But at the same time, we also need to have a discussion, because they're not represented here tonight, about the hundreds and hundreds of faiths and denominations which want the freedom to marry same-sex couples in their church and have ministry for them.
Right, and that's the church that I go to, which is All Saints Episcopal Church on Wilson Avenue. And Kristen and I went there, and we had our marriage blessed there. So, it's a shame that they're not represented here, but they're out there.
Well, I don't know that nothing in this bill is stopping your church from blessing what they consider to be a marriage. I mean, there's nothing stopping that. But I would say when you title a bill Religious Freedom, and you've got numerous places where religious freedoms are being impinged, and you've got the law professors, including law professors, as Bob said, they are the experts. I mean, I'm a country lawyer. That's about all I am. But these guys.
Can I quote you on that?
You can go ahead.
Country lawyer.
That's all okay. I went to law school to be. Yeah. But there are experts who are pro same-sex marriage, who said, look, if you're going to do this, for heaven's sakes, make the religious liberty protection robust. I mean, what do you say to that wedding photographer who now no longer can do business? She can't practice her artistic profession. And as you know, a wedding photographer, that's not a minor involvement in your ceremony and service. I mean, she spends all day with you planning. They've got to artistically create this memory of your
she does,
event.
She was a little annoying, I must say.
But right, that too.
Yeah,
yes.
They do spend a lot of time with you.
Right. But can you
know
imagine
what? In
if
Illinois,
this is an evangelical Christian, very strong Christian woman.
Right.
She didn't agree at all with this lesbian commitment ceremony she was asked to photograph. Should she be forced to do that?
I can just say that we've got over a decade now of experience in 13 states, and this issue has never arisen, other than in theory. And as far as experts,
we have
a number of expert lawyers who look at the bill and they see one thing. We have a number of expert lawyers who look at the bill and they say another.
I mean, don't you guys represent the bed and breakfast owner in Alton?
Well, we don't, but we are our co-counsel with the folks that do. I mean, you've got a downstate bed and breakfast that didn't want to turn over their, it's a family business, their home for a same-sex civil union, I believe in that case, for a full weekend.
But it's a business that does business in the state of Illinois. In the state of Illinois, we don't allow discrimination.
But you see, but you... but here's the thing. The difference is this. You could stay there with your partner, and they wouldn't
want...
And you know what?
Terminology is important.
For me, from my own religious perspective and the laws of the state of Illinois,
I'm married. I have a marriage license.
And fair enough. Okay. Fair enough. And you've been married in your church. But what I would say is you could stay there on a weekend. They wouldn't reject you a room. The issue is are they going to be compelled to participate in a religious ceremony that they disagree with fundamentally?
Well, if it's in a bed and breakfast, how is that a religious ceremony?
Well, you have the ceremony out in the backyard.
But
right there.
But what if they have a judge back there?
Well, no, it's
and it's a business.
But their property is being compelled to be used for this.
That's our point.
Whether
about
it's the photographer, whether it's the bed and breakfast.
That's my point about the law being a blunt instrument, and that has ripple effects. And it doesn't seem that the individuals who are advocating for this legislation are adequately taking our concerns into consideration. And so what we were asking for is we'll put a stronger religious liberty protection in the legislation.
I mean, when we sat with the chancellor of the archdiocese early on, we talked through a lot of these issues and your issues regarding the church, fellowship halls, parish halls, anything similar. We put those in. Those are in the Senate Bill 10. It was in the amendment we put forward. This is consonant with, and we had a lot of back and forth about how the Supreme Court of the United States has looked at religious freedom to be sure that what we're doing in this law is not only respecting religion as far as this bill, but also respects it as far as what the Supreme Court of the United States has said our Constitution guarantees.
I just go back to my original point, which is that the experts that Peter alluded to have all said that this is the weakest bill in the country with regard to religious liberty protections, and it would be better if that bill were afforded more protections, religious organizations.
Just the line in the civil union bill, protecting religious ministries, isn't even in this bill.
Oh, yes, it is.
No, that one was stripped out. And you can check it out, Greg. I don't mean to delay the debate, but it's a discussion.
We got time.
Debate. Yeah.
And I brought the highlighted.
Sure, you've got the highlighted.
We have time for the actual bill.
Sure. We're going to have a dramatic reading.
Yeah, we'll have a dramatic reading.
Now we're really
but in lieu of the dramatic reading of two pages of legalese, I see our timekeeper has come up here.
Okay.
Anyone who wants to come up and take a look at this?
All right, this isn't exactly a direct quote, but Pope Francis recently said, back off. One of the things he said was, religion has the right to express its opinion in the service of the people, but God in creation has set us free. It is not possible to interfere spiritually in the life of a person. This has caused a lot of debate within the church. What's your read on what he said and what he intended?
And here's the thing. The wonderful thing about what Pope Francis has reminded us is that we have this debate. We are children of God all together, and we have great respect for one another. And folks ask me, like, how do I get, you know, oh, what about Harris? How is he? Like, we're cracking jokes in the back before we go on together. I mean, no, we're colleagues. We appreciate one another, and we have to respect one another in that way. So when the Pope talks about, you know, not imposing on the religious beliefs of others, look, you can go to your Episcopal church, you can have a marriage ceremony if you'd like. The issue here, though, then goes to what is best for society. Are we going to redefine this to be the love relationship of two people, or are we going to continue that focus on, look, we're here with marriage to provide for the mom and the dad of that child in a stable relationship. If that's the focus, then we're right. If the other is the focus, then they're right. That's really what it comes down to.
Well, I think we agree that we need what's best for the children. And I think children are in families with same-sex couples, and they need the protections.
But again,
the federal government. Yeah. And I mean, it's existing. Are you going to deny that it's not existing? And so if it is, we want those children to have the same protection.
With regard to the Pope and what he said, I read the whole document. I didn't see back off in there.
It was actually the original Italian. I might have been paraphrasing.
With regard to what the Pope said, I know there's been a lot of attention to this. But I think it's important that we really reflect on the true message of what the Pope was saying. What the Pope was asking us is how does the Catholic Church encounter the world? And how do we draw people towards salvation? Because ultimately that's what the church is really interested in, is the salvation of souls. So what's the best way that we can communicate our message in a welcoming environment? It's important to note, though, that as the church is challenged to be more welcoming to diverse people, the Pope did not change any teachings about the Catholic Church regarding marriage. And that's what we're up here talking about, is marriage being between the union of one man and one woman. So the church's teachings still stand, and I think what the Pope was inviting us to, and you know what, let's think about it. You don't have to be Catholic. Don't we all need to be more welcoming to people who are diverse? I mean, we all need to be more welcoming, and that's what the Pope is really challenging us to do.
He did say the teaching of the church is clear. He affirmed that. He also said we don't need to be talking about these issues all the time. How do you read that?
We don't. We don't talk about these issues all the time. And yeah. I know Alderman Mell talked about, are we going to get any pension questions tonight? No, I mean, look, there are other things to talk about through society.
That's for the reception.
Oh, fair enough. You know, it was interesting. Our pastor preached about this weekend. And he said, look, when we talk about these things, the focus for people of faith is on the faith first. And for Christians, it's on the person of Jesus Christ. And then your beliefs flow out from that. Your particular moral teachings here or there on a particular topic flow out from that. But if you're not spreading the faith, then what kind of a Christian are you? And I will say, when we go to religious liberty and we talk about what does religious liberty mean, we can't cabinet to the four walls of the church. I mean, Christians are called to go forth and to preach the gospel. You can't do that in the four walls of your church. You can't baptize the nations if you stay inside the church walls. It's kind of tough to go talk to everybody who's outside. So that's one of the differences you're seeing here, kind of as a side issue to the marriage issue. What does it mean for that wedding photographer, for the bed and breakfast owner, and for others like that? For the public school teacher who says, hey, I believe that marriage is between a man and a woman. I don't really want to be out teaching my kids in my classroom about these other relationships, equating them to marriage, because it is required under state law to teach about marriage. It is, as part of our sex ed curriculum. So, I mean, that will come up, and I know there are teachers in the audience. So, I mean, that's something that I would imagine would be a concern of theirs, too.
I will just tell you, because when those of us who are in Springfield take our oath of office, we swear to defend and uphold the Constitution of the State of Illinois and the Constitution of the United States of America. And as we make laws, that is what we are charged to do with. So, yeah, I can't necessarily comment on what the Pope says. I'm not a Catholic. I don't feel it's my position to speak to what he says. But what our law says is that in America, every person is treated equally in the eyes of the law. And that's what we need to do.
Just real follow-up. I also feel like, I can't also speak for the Pope, but I do feel that he was more, I have a lot of straight friends who are Catholics, who go to church, right, and who believe in marriage for same-sex couples. So I think it's more of, I was really like heartened with the softening from the Catholic Church, and I think what he was also saying is, let's put our energy and our focus on unwanted pregnancies, right, incarceration, gun violence. I mean, let's, you know, so I was happy to see that. It was such a switch, right, from Rome. So
I want to get to some questions from the audience. Why does the state have to be involved in the licensing and definition of marriage? Can marriage just remain a religious institution without the state involvement?
I think Peter and I have been pointing that out, it's a public good. Marriage is a public good. Marriage is the institution that takes one man and one woman and binds their child to the man and a woman. And so it has an effect that I think the public needs to recognize, that this is how we transmit our faith and our values, and this is how we procreate for future generations. So there is a public interest in strong marriages. And I think we've seen in society, when we have strong marriages, we have a strong society. Mm-hmm. And right now, the marriage culture, unfortunately, is not very strong.
I think this is one point we all agree on. Yeah. Right?
The law only talks about civil marriage. Religious marriage and the consecration of marriage is left to the individual faiths. And there are some people who could not get married in a particular faith. There are some people who choose not to be married in any faith. They may go to the judge or the county clerk. But in the eyes of the law, all need to be treated equally. Even in the Catholic Church, there are some people, for instance, who might have been divorced who could not get married in the Catholic Church. But when they go to see David Orr will give them a marriage license.
Another question from the audience, it's similar. If marriage is a right, then why put any boundaries on it? And I noticed, you know, that the bill does create actually new restrictions on who can marry. Why not, why would this bill, if it is a right, limit marriages to people?
I can talk about what my bill does, which is very clear about two adults. That is what's before us. That's what I've introduced, and that's what is before the General Assembly to vote on.
Marriage is, you find that person that you want to spend the rest of your life with. That one person you want to spend the rest of your life with. That's what marriage is.
But that bill does say an uncle and a nephew cannot marry, a sibling cannot marry.
So does the current marriage law.
I think the underlying question is, why should the state put any... Why not declare marriage a right for whomever or how many ever you wish?
Okay, I can talk about the legislation I've introduced, which is about creating stable families and loving families and building communities. That's my bill. It treats same-sex couples and opposite-sex couples equally.
But laws have purposes. I mean, we have restrictions on speed limits because of highway safety, right? We have restrictions on how much pollution you can put in the air for public health reasons. So the law has a purpose, and the law teaches. And I think that's what the heart of this question is getting at, is why do we have marriage between one man and one woman? Well, we have a man and a woman who come together for the purpose of procreation and producing a child. That's two people. So that's two. But the question is a good one. Well, why can't it be, if once you take gender out of a marriage, that's the underlying principle and that's the rationale behind our position, behind what Peter and I are saying. But once you take man and woman out of it, why can't you have three? Why can't you have four? There's no reason why. There's no underlying position. There's no underlying rationale behind your position.
If the law teaches, I hope that this bill will teach love. It will teach commitment.
That's not the law's responsibility, Greg. The law doesn't Representative Harris, the law has no interest in love. The law has an interest in a common good called marriage for the procreation of children. That's the law's interest.
We're going to have a show of hands at the end to see how the audience reacted to
our
presentation.
I didn't mean to cut you off. I'm sorry.
So this is something I've always kind of wanted to ask. And so if a couple gets married, right, and they can't procreate,
sure.
So then should that marriage be dissolved?
No.
I mean, if that's...
No, because it shouldn't. Number one, when a man and a woman get
older people.
Okay, when a man and woman get married, number one, things can change. suddenly they could produce a child. They may not want to. They may change their mind. Number two, they act as examples in public about what a marriage is between a man and a woman. So they have aunts, they have nieces and nephews, they could be caretakers for children. They're an example of what marriage is.
You just described Kristen and I.
They were an example of what
marriage
is.
You just described Kristen and I.
No. Because I didn't, because I used a man and a woman in my example, so with all due respect, I didn't describe
you. No, it's okay, Bob, but you
did.
I mean, okay, go ahead.
No, I didn't. I answered your question as best I could. But I didn't use people of the same gender.
I mean, Deb, you're describing my wife and I.
Oh, okay.
So, I mean, you know, we are in the midst of an adoption process. And here's the difference to me. It's, you know what, any two people can fall in love, but every child has a mom and a dad. And so, and we know, there they go again. And so that when you look at it, and look at the purposes of marriage. Why can't an uncle and a niece get married? Because of the procreative aspects. I mean, why is, there's a grounds for annulment, non-consummation of the marriage, not to get too graphic here, but like, why is that? It's because of the procreative aspect. So written into our law is this procreative aspect. And so that really is changing if you redefine marriage. It is a true redefinition, and we need to understand that if that's going to occur.
And I don't think we're redefining it all. We're simply expanding what our law does to reflect what society looks like.
Question from the audience, and I think this goes to comments that you made earlier about data. If empirical data over a multi-year period demonstrated that same-sex couples raise healthy, well-adjusted, and loving children, would the Catholic Church change its view on this issue?
Well, it's a hypothetical question, and
I think it was Peter earlier who raised exactly.
I was going to let His Holiness answer, so that was easy.
No, because as I just outlined our position as earlier, is that marriage is the union between one man and one woman for the purposes of procreation and raising of a child. And that's the underlying premise of our whole, that's the underlying premise of why government is involved with this issue.
Yeah, but shouldn't healthy children be the goal?
But you see, we
healthy
do a both
children.
And. This is a Catholic thing, and not to be particularly, but you know, there's the both and. Always talk about that. You can have healthy children, you can also reaffirm the institution of marriage. So, I mean, you can do both. And so we can strengthen and protect marriage so that, you know, this epidemic of fatherlessness that has gripped our city and our state can be reversed. But we can also still ensure for healthy children, just as we always have. For kids who are not in a situation where they're being raised by their biological mom and dad in a stable relationship. We can do both. So you just don't have to redefine marriage in order to do so.
What about all the divorces?
All right. We've been restricted to questions from the moderator. Sorry. We can talk afterwards, though.
I will pick up on that, though.
Okay.
50% of divorces, or marriages end in divorce. I think it's something like 40% of children are born out of wedlock. I would argue that marriage is already a very struggling institution, and the question that usually is raised is, how would permitting more marriages somehow undermine that?
Well, we should be strengthening and promoting marriages, and we should be looking at public policies that strengthen and promote marriage as it exists today. Redefining marriage to be something that it's historically not is not the solution to why marriages are currently failing.
Mm-hmm. So would that be changing the... How did someone get a divorce, or how would you?
Well, that's one thing. You could, there's been states that have reduced the amount that it costs to get a marriage license, and if you take a reduced fee, you could.
So, do you think there's 50% divorce rate because the fee is too high to get the marriage license?
I didn't say that.
Let's reduce the fee, Greg.
Well, no, but that's not what I said. That's not where I was going with that. I mean, but there's things you can do. There's policies and there's programs that you can do to educate people about what they're going to do when they get married.
I think it's great.
And that's other states have done that.
It's a
great
idea.
Yet the General Assembly in Illinois has never taken us up on that offer. So there's a lot of things we can do to strengthen marriage in our culture. We don't need to be redefining it.
Yeah. Well, there's also, I think, North Carolina or something, you have to wait, be separated for a year until you get married. Would you support something like that then?
Well, I mean, you know, there's no doubt that no-fault divorce has contributed to the increase in out-of-wedlock birth rates and stuff. But I'm not arguing Yeah, I'm not arguing that we go back to the 70s, because there were problems there too, but I think what you see is way too many children born out of wedlock. Look at the problems that's having. I mean, President Obama has said that recently in his Father's Day speech. He said that, I think it was children who are raised without fathers are 5 times more likely to be in poverty. They're 9 times more likely to drop out of school, and they're 20 times more likely to be in prison.
And I think
so
the reason,
children need both a mother and a father to
and
raise
I think
them.
The reason the president... Don't want to step on your applause line.
Sorry.
And I think one of the reasons that President Obama has been such a strong supporter of marriage equality is because he wants to see more stable families raising children and bettering our communities.
Let's end with this question from the audience. I want to ask each of you, 25 years from today, how will history view the debate over same-sex marriage?
Well, I hope I'm around to see it 25 years from now. You know, that's a good question. I hope that society takes me up on the offer that I just outlined, that we as a society realize the damage that we are inflicting upon our children, with far too many children born out of wedlock, far too many children, as I said, in poverty, dropout rates in prison, and that we strengthen and we promote marriage. And I think we need to recognize, as Peter has stated, that you know, no amount of love in the world can make a mother a good father and a father a good mother. And hopefully in 25 years, we have strong, vibrant marriages. We'll have a second generation who will be even that much stronger in their commitment to finding a loving husband or a wife so they can raise future generations of children.
Mm-hmm. Deb?
Bruce, I think, you know, I think it's gonna be a shameful period in our history. And we are really going to regret what we've done to gay and lesbian families in this country. And I'm really heartened, like I said, about, like, you know, the Supreme Court decision and 13 states, you know, already have it on the books in the District of Columbia. But I think as a society, we will move forward. And we will value all relationships, and I just I'm really hopeful. It's such an exciting time, you know. We've been doing this. I got arrested at a gay marriage rally in 2004, and to think, and at that time it was just Massachusetts, right? And now to think that all these other states and the Supreme Court, you know, I when that ruling came down, Kristen was I was out of town that time, and I called her on the phone. I was just like just crying, you know, and she thought that the Supreme Court ruled the other way. But I was just, it was just so validating to know that our Supreme Court values our relationships and realizes that we need the protections and fairness that marriage gives people. So I think I'm very hopeful. I think we're going to look back on this, and it's going to be kind of a shameful time.
Okay. I think when we look back 25 years from now, we're going to be thankful for this period of our history, because as we've made the point but not maybe said directly, we've made a mess of marriage. It's been 50 years where we've just continued to make a mess of marriage. And this debate is forcing us as a people to start reevaluating, why do we even have marriage in the first place? And I see a community 25 years from now that will have learned that lesson, will reaffirm the institution, will understand that we've got to protect and strengthen the institution, as Bob has said, not to undermine it, not to redefine it, and that we refocus our efforts on the children to try to make sure that as many kids as possible who today are without their fathers or today are without their mothers for whatever reason, that as many kids as possible are able to be raised by their own biological parents in a stable home. That's what I see us in 25 years. I see us looking back and being thankful that we had the wake-up call that we're getting here in 2013.
Greg, you get the last word.
I think if you want to get a glimmer of what public opinion is going to look like in 25 years, you can look at what public opinion is today. And for especially young people, you know, 35 and under, well over 70% believe in marriage equality. So 25 years from now, I think this will be a given in society that all families should be treated equal. And when people talk about this, they're going to look back at a time, just as we look back now on, women were never allowed to vote or work outside the home, and say, you know, what were they thinking back then, and when marriage equality is the law of the land?
Yeah.
Female vote was cast in the village of Lombard, Illinois, by the way.
Who was the trustee?
Ellen Martin. No, but she was the voter, but I don't know the trustee was.
You've all been wonderful. I want to thank you for a very heated but respectful debate, and I want to thank the audience for your questions, and now you get to applaud all of them.